Hello, I'm Tony Velasquez, and welcome to Future Perfect. In this week's Science and Tech Wrap, we'll look at the latest gadgets and the patent dispute between Apple and Samsung. Bloomberg reports the CEOs of Apple and Samsung will try to resolve their patent dispute before the case is decided by a jury. Both companies traded accusations during the trial, revealing strategy and product information. Apple presented evidence of how Samsung had compared its Galaxy phones to the iPhone and concluded that in order to offer customers a better experience, the Galaxy should emulate much of the iPhone's functionality. Meantime, Apple is now the most valuable company in history with a valuation of $621 billion. On Mars, NASA's Curiosity rover fired its laser for the first time, zapping a rock on the red planet. The ChemCam blasted a fist-sized rock with 30 pulses of its laser, turning the rock's atoms into an ionized glowing plasma, which NASA can analyze to determine its elements. If you're looking for the latest cool gadgets, the Google Nexus 7 tablet is designed for media consumption, with convenient apps for magazine and book reading, movie watching, and music listening. The Android tablet can run any app from Facebook to Photoshop. Its 7-inch screen is comfortable to hold in one hand. For those who like the feel of a keyboard and don't want anything bulky to carry, the TouchFire screen-top keyboard for iPad might be what they're looking for. A flexible piece of transparent rubber that sits on the iPad's on-screen keyboard, it has key-shaped bumps and attaches magnetically. Snap-happy Pinoys will love the Samsung WB105F camera, which allows users to share photos with its built-in Wi-Fi. Pics can be shared via email, social sites, or cloud services as long as you've got a wireless connection. You can even use the Wi-Fi to control the camera with your phone. Good when you want to be in the shot. And coming up, PhilAm geophysicist Lawrence Cocioco of Global Energy and Environment Solutions Company, based in Houston, Texas, to discuss their geophysics services to address environmental issues. Keep it here on Future Perfect Tech Shorts. Welcome back to Future Perfect Tech Shorts. Our guest tonight is PhilAm geophysicist Lawrence Cocioco. He's the president of the GeoNano Technology Company. Now, his company currently specializes in providing near-surface geophysics services, we'll get to explain that later, to address environmental, engineering, mining, energy, and national security issues, among others. So thank you very much, Lawrence, for coming over.
Well, thank you, Tony, for having me here.
Yeah. So do you fly in and out of the Philippines frequently?
Yes. In fact, for the last 3-5 years, I've been coming here 3-4 times.
Mm-hmm. And that's basically to do what?
Hopefully, I can do consulting work and at the same time, of course, visit my mother who's based here.
Okay. That's the more important
point. That's the more important, yes.
Mom, all right. Well, as a geophysicist, what disciplines do you have to apply to your craft? So you have physics, of course.
Yes.
And a knowledge of geology. How
Correct.
Do the two come into play?
Well, what happened is that basically geophysics is geophysics is a field where you apply physical laws.
The laws of physics.
Laws of physics that you could probe into the subsurface, the earth, and just look for mineral deposits or any anomalies below the ground from near surface, like engineering the pipelines, if there's a break in the pipe or there's a subsidence or
sinkholes. So that's what it
sinkholes.
Means. Near
right.
surface
near
means
very shallow.
Very shallow depths. Okay.
Then you could use the same technology where you could probe deeper, like for mineral deposits, down to about 500 meters to 1,000 meters. Then if you want to look for oil exploration, which are deeper, like more than 10,000 meters, then you have to use heavier equipment, larger arrays of geophones and vibrosize. For land or offshore, you use boats with air guns.
Now, we have, do we have that kind of expertise here in the Philippines? I mean, exploration for deep, or how do you call it?
Deep sea exploration.
Deep exploration.
Deep seismic.
Yeah.
To my knowledge, the capability we have in this country is very limited. Many of the geophysicists in this country do not have adequate training, like in the international field.
Yeah.
So And there's a big gap there, okay? Oh. And that's the reason why I'm hoping that I can come here and provide some training. Yeah. And just like through the Ateneo, I'm trying to convince the Father Jet Villarin that we need to start boosting earth sciences program here.
Mm. And that's what you're actually here for, right? I mean, you just recently or have opened a new college in Ateneo.
No, not yet. It's still being proposed.
It's still being
proposed.
Right,
the School of Earth Sciences, right. And it'll take a few more years to build that up. But I'm very active. My corporate headquarters is based in Houston, Texas. Mm-hmm. But I've expanded my operations to Mongolia.
Okay.
I'm there engaged in mineral exploration in terms of, let's say, coal, gold, mm-hmm. iron ore, and so forth. But I started also doing oil exploration services. I have a company that can do 2D or 3D seismic work.
Yeah. Now, why would a School of Earth Sciences be that important for the Philippines?
Well, for one thing, there's a lot of challenges. Actually, when you think about it, the Philippines is an ideal country. It's located along the Pacific Rim of Fire.
Yeah.
So all the volcanisms, typhoons, rich mineral deposits, and so forth, you require a lot of remote sensing technologies to do a lot of mapping.
Yeah.
Okay, so we want to do things the intelligent way. So one way to minimize environmental impact, just imagine if you're looking for a mineral deposit, and a lot of mining companies, they just do drilling. They just probe a lot of holes in the ground, and when you find a drilling location, you have to bulldoze, clear a path. So it's environmental. It has a major impact on the environment.
Yeah.
But with geophysics, you can do a lot, like a CAT scan.
Yeah.
Of
imaging.
The Earth. Yeah. Imaging. Right. Mm-hmm. So you can come up with 2D or 3D images, though you know where the sweet spots are.
Yeah.
And you could do a more intelligent and more cost-effective way of doing exploration.
I actually read an article, and this is just an interesting sidelight. Mm-hmm. Nothing to do with looking for mineral resources, but mostly looking for old grave sites.
Yes.
They actually tapped your expertise and your equipment to help them locate old grave sites without having to necessarily excavate everything.
Right. Yeah. Yes. That's right.
You used imaging, right?
Yes. Some of this technology, we call them non-invasive remote sensing technology. Yes, I've done some surveys for some government agencies looking for archaeological sites.
Have they asked you to look for the Yamashita gold?
Well, if you know a good site, we can go there and investigate. Why not?
Yes, if that doesn't turn out to be a myth. Now, earth sciences, yes, very timely, especially with what we experienced in the past several weeks. Monsoon rains, terrific calamity, horrific calamity, and everybody suffers, from the same kind of rainfall that we had from Ondoy.
Mm-hmm.
And nobody seems to know whether we can predict that kind of calamity again. In the study of earth sciences, does that actually help a better forecasting capability as well?
Yes, it will help. Because like anything else, you need to have a baseline. Mm. You need to conduct some preliminary studies to record some data information. Then when subsequent events occur, then you could see what's going on. For example, in an area that we know that's high prone for landslides.
Yeah.
So what we can do is that we could set up, we can instrument that area with geophysical instruments. Then we could have that data collected on a recorded in real time and have that information logged. So if there's going to be any ground movement, it could set off an alarm.
But I'm actually curious, Lawrence, because the Philippine government has for several years now been very conscientious about mapping so-called geohazard sites. Mines and Geosciences Bureau locally, they've tried to identify these so-called geohazardous sites.
Mm-hmm.
But do you think they haven't been able to accurately identify these areas because they don't have the kind of equipment or technology that you're talking about?
You not only need the equipment, you need to have the right professionals who know how to use it and interpret.
Uh-huh.
Okay, and we have the same problem even in the U.S. where, as I mentioned to you earlier, that we have a lot of geoscientists, whether they're geophysicists, geologists, they spend too much time in the computer room. And they do a lot of simulations. Computer modeling and so forth. You cannot find oil or coal sitting in your computer lab just playing with the computers, okay? You need to get out there in the field.
You need to get your hands dirty.
Right, get your hands dirty, gain a lot of experience. It'll put hair on your chest.
Hey, nobody wants hair on their chest anymore. They want to wax themselves. Okay. But when you think about it, in this country, there are a lot of mineral resources that companies are interested in locating, exploiting, and all that. And the kind of debate that we have about mining and mm-hmm. the destructive processes that it mm-hmm. actually entails, the kind of technology that you're talking about, imaging, does that actually do away with some of the destructive, you know, clearing of the land and excavation and all that?
That technology can also be used to address them. Mm. As I said, let's say, for example, we have an area that's not been mined yet, right?
Yeah.
So what, like, let me cite the U.S. side. Okay, the United States has one of the toughest environmental laws, mining laws. Mm. Okay, and yet a lot of companies are doing business, making good profit. Mm. Okay, and
but abiding by the laws.
Abiding by the laws, okay. Enforcement, right? And so that's the key. Okay, mm. and on the upstream side, you have to employ technologies to lower your operating costs or capex costs.
Yeah.
So when you find a good sweet spot, for example, you have a big mine, mm-hmm. and to start to operate the mine, you need to find a sweet spot where you have the highest concentration of gold,
ores.
Ores, right. Yeah. So to get the company started, you need to find the sweet spot and you concentrate, put your plant in there, the mine, the shaft, and so forth,
yeah.
like that.
So you need a kind of exploration technology mm-hmm. that would do minimal, that would have a minimal impact
right.
on the environment, the ecology. Yeah,
right, and the only way you can have minimal impact is to employ innovative, advanced geophysical technologies, okay. whether if it's electromagnetics, EM, IP, or seismic.
And that's something that the proposed School of Earth Sciences should be able to introduce, right?
Well, yes. Yeah. Father Jeff Valerian and I were very close friends. We were both physics majors in college. Mm-hmm. So we discussed about this for the last 10 years. Finally, the timing is right.
All right. Well, hopefully so. Now, talking about timing, and another topic that is so hot mm-hmm. Geopolitically, not just mm-hmm. geophysically. Mm-hmm. Geopolitically, we're talking about the Spratt lease, and the object of desire, obviously, is the untapped resources there, whether it be mineral or aquatic. Your proposal is, you said, why should everybody get stuck mm-hmm. Squabbling mm-hmm. Over this area when everybody could just cooperate and utilize the resources?
Yeah. Right. Yeah. As a third person, sitting in Houston, Texas, when I read the articles, what's going on in the South China Sea, I kind of, I'm bewildered. Mm. Because usually most new frontier exploration, it's usually a joint ventures between countries or big national companies or independents and so forth.
New frontier?
Yeah, new
and
frontier.
And it's usually joint? Why is that?
Oh, yeah, well, to leverage the risk. Because usually the risk in the new frontiers is very high.
Yeah.
So they share the risk. They bring in a lot of partners involved to explore this area.
Okay.
So, but I don't know the details. What went on before this thing happened, the years before, what kind of contracts, negotiations between governments or corporations.
Yeah.
But I just find it fascinating that in this case, no one wins.
If they go on it by themselves.
Yeah, or they argue, okay? Right. Because everybody needs oil. Mm-hmm. Okay, especially China. And the reason why I mentioned about China is because, again, I've been in the oil industry for 30 years in the U.S., and I've seen that, there's nothing to gain, especially in a situation like this. And given that China has a much greater demand, they are consuming about 8.2 million barrels of oil a day, okay? Then you compare that, of course, the U.S. is the largest consumer of oil. But when you and China imports 56% of their daily requirements in oil, so it comes down to about 4.6 million barrels of oil a day. Mm. Compared to the Philippines is only 338,000 barrels of oil. Mm. So the Philippine consumption of oil is only about 7.3%. So China has more to gain if they learn how to cooperate in a joint venture like this, or in anywhere.
But I'm actually wondering whether or not they feel that the risk is acceptable for them to mm-hmm. handle on their own, because they actually even had one of their deep sea oil rigs, I think, moved over to a part of that area, right?
Mm-hmm.
I mean, to start drilling.
Right, right. So if they did that, they're trying to probe the kind of the lithology, the geology, if they're a good hydrocarbon source.
Yeah.
Okay. But of course, we've seen how the Chinese reacted. Like CNOOC. There have been a Philippine company here is trying to talk to CNOOC about joint ventures. Then 3 weeks later, 3 weeks ago, they went out and bought a Canadian company, Nexen, for $15.1 billion.
Okay.
So all these acquisitions that's going on is one way for them to leverage their risk. It's cheaper to increase your reserves by buying other oil companies.
Okay, so that's how they're doing it. Mm.
That's how they're doing right now.
Right.
Things could change.
Mm.
Yeah.
Now, given your expertise, I'm sure you must be pretty curious what's underneath the waters of the Spratly area, right? Because, I mean, it's virtually still unmapped. I mean, in terms of just what could be underneath. I mean, everybody's talking in theory. There must be potentially millions of barrels of oil, whatever, or even other kind of mineral deposits. Is it that difficult to actually estimate what's underneath?
Well, in this particular situation, let's talk about the Recto Bank.
Yeah.
Okay. There's a lot of speculation or studies made by only two Norwegian geophysicists that they come up with over a trillion cubic feet of gas. And that's it.
That's gas, not oil. Huh?
Not oil.
Gas.
Okay. Just gas only. Yeah. Okay. So, but the problem is that you need to let other people look at it too, because
get a second
opinion, third opinion. Because geophysics is an inexact science. It's not 1 + 1 = 2. It could be in this range. So when you have something like 2 + 2 in geophysics, it's like, oh, it's between 3 and 5, you know, in that range. Right. So you need to bring in more other independent experts or consultants to look at that thing. Mm. Okay, someone asked me, one prominent businessman asked me if I would invest in this prospect.
Sure, we know who that prominent businessman is, right? Because he's already in talks with the Chinese, right?
Okay, so of course, not seeing the data, I have seen the data, so I said, I can't until I've seen and studied the data myself or with my staff and come up with our own interpretation and analysis, then I would think about it. Mm. But right now, when you're trying to promote, there's a lot of hype that's going on, you know, and, and from a third person sitting back in Houston, I said, wow, it's unbelievable, you know, about...
Well, it's the most politically charged area in the Philippine Sea, or they call it the South China Sea.
Right, right.
So it's not that easy to actually get all the conflicting parties to agree.
It's very complex. Right, right. Mm. Especially when the stakes are high. Mm. You remember I mentioned some one of the... people here that, you know, it's like a Texas Hold'em poker game, you know. Everybody these cards and they think that they have the best
hand. And everybody's bluffing.
Everybody's holding, you know. Mm. So, but the longer it plays out, nobody wins.
Now, aside from just looking at potential mineral resources or gas deposits in the Recto Bank or somewhere else in the Spratlys, where else do you think we should be looking at? Here in the Philippines, or have we tapped mostly everything now? Overtapped, maybe.
Well, to be honest with you, I think the Philippines is largely still underexplored.
Really?
There are so many areas that
don't tell that to the folks in Palawan.
Oh, no, I'm talking about the other parts of the country.
Okay, then, because they don't want mining there.
Yes, yeah. But one area that that I read of very positive news is that Benham Rice, the United Nations have issued press that it belongs to the Philippines. So, without any potential conflict, that's a nice area to explore, to look into. Yeah, and there are other parts in the country that I felt that it's not fully explored.
Yeah. And the kind of mining technology that the local companies have here could use some updating, right?
Oh, yes.
Yeah, because they don't... do we have any 3D imaging? Or imaging at all, 2D, 3D? No.
No.
It's just mostly drill and bring up the core sample and evaluate it, right?
And make a big guess between the drill holes. Usually the drill holes are like more than a kilometer apart, or depending on if they do a lot of infill drilling.
Right.
But usually in exploration, those holes are like 2-3 kilometers apart. Mm. So anything can happen in between. So if you miss a target, oops.
Sure.
Or if you hit a good gold, let's say coal seam here, then 2 kilometers later you hit another coal seam, you assume, the geologists assume that the coal is uniformly thick across.
Yeah.
But anything can happen in between. Mm.
What about in Malampaya? I mean, do we need to actually do more exploration there?
Again, I cannot make any comments about it because I have not seen the data.
But they've actually tapped a huge reserve, right?
The gas
natural
reserve,
gas.
Right. Yeah. And it's supposed to last 20 years.
Mm. Yeah. So if there's natural gas in that area, is it highly likely that in some proximate area there could be more?
Oh yes, of course.
So which is pretty important because... you know, just like the human body, you got to let the gas out every now and then. What is the time frame for the School of Earth Sciences anyway?
Hopefully, maybe 3-5 years.
3 to 5 years.
Yeah.
Okay. And that's because you need to get what? Funding for it?
I have to dig more coal and find more gold to fund it.
Right.
So that's why I'm very active in Mongolia.
Because you need to actually put the equipment that the students will be using in the field, right? And it's the kind of equipment that you personally employ.
Right.
The imaging equipment.
And not only that, to set up a curriculum, then to find other Filipino expats that I know very personally who are very good in geophysics as well, that I can utilize for this university.
Must be like a brain drain of trained geophysicists who are out there, right? I mean, most of you guys have relocated abroad.
Unfortunately, we have to, because there are no opportunities here.
I see.
Yeah.
Okay. So, well, before the tear drops from my eye, I just I just want to thank you, Lawrence Gotshoko, for coming over and sharing with us your insights, as well as your future plans. Good luck with that.
Oh, thank
you,
Tony.
School of Earth Sciences. I think the Philippines will really reap the benefits of having something like that.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
Yes.
But looking forward to it. Yeah. And looking forward to seeing the plans come to fruition.
Thank you.
All right. And thank you for joining us. I'm Tony Velasquez. You can join me again next week when we again examine the present and look ahead to the future perfect of Philippine Tech.